So at this philosophical level, there's one last thing I want to talk about. We just talked about evaluating a policy, but remember, in the reinforcement learning setting, the policy is what gets output as a result of the learning process. So what if we want to actually evaluate the learner? How good is this learner? Can you think of some ways that we might be able to decide how good a learner is?
Sure. It's as good as its policy.
So that seems like a good idea, that a good learner is one that returns a good policy. Sure. What if we have two learners that return the same policy, say the optimal policy?
Oh, okay. Well, I can think of two responses to that. One is, who cares? They're both the same, and the only thing that matters is how good the policy is that you come up with. Or I could come up with another answer, which would be, I will take the one that does it more quickly.
Quickly in terms of what?
Let's say time.
I think that's what quickly means, yes. But like time of what? There's lots of different kinds of time that matter. So one in particular is computation time.
Yeah. Wall clock time.
And that seems like an important one, right? We want one that's going to be more efficient in terms of the computations that it does in the process of learning the policy. But there's another kind of time that actually matters a lot in the reinforcement learning setting. So I think it's worth mentioning.
Okay.
So the other kind of complexity that turns out to be really important in this learning setting is experience complexity. Do you have a sense of what that might mean?
How complex your experiences are?
I'm going to say no.
Oh, okay. Well, get it. So computational complexity is sort of how much computational energy you have to put into it. So this would be how much experience you have to have in order to learn. So it's like the amount of data that you need.
Yeah. So if two different learners can learn the same optimal policy, but one only requires a couple interactions with the environment to do it, and the other one requires a billion, you know, the one that has the lower experience complexity should be preferred, though, of course, there's trade-offs. I mean, if it to do that, it actually has to compute for 2 billion years, then that seems maybe not so good either. So there can be little trade-offs between how much time that the learner takes in terms of interactions with the environment and how much time that it takes in terms of the computations that it does between interactions.
So you know what this reminds me of? It reminds me of two things. It reminds me of MIMIC, because that was the exact trade-off that we were making then.
Yeah. Okay, sure.
And the other thing is, it reminds me of the theory lecture that we did in the Intro to Machine Learning class when we talked about sample complexity.
Yes, that's good. That probably is a better name than experience complexity. Let's call it sample complexity. Yeah, because it really is about the data that's necessary to be able to achieve the learning ends.
All right.
All right, so this kind of sets the stage for what reinforcement learning is and how we compare different learners to each other and how we compare the outputs of those learners to each other. What we're going to dive into next is actual algorithms for doing this kind of learning.
Okay, that sounds cool. Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
So why aren't we talking about space?
Ooh. So space complexity. So that's a good question. In computer science, usually computation time and computation space are the two dimensions along which we evaluate algorithms. Here, I guess we could do that too. You could talk about the space that an algorithm uses, a learning algorithm uses, but it's generally not that interesting. Generally, we're not limited by the space complexity. We usually run into issues more quickly on the computational or the sample complexity side.